Hello everyone, this is Dr. Adel Bondok, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. Today I am going to talk about the digestive system. I will talk about it in questions and answers. So I will start by what are the parts of the GIT and what are the accessory organs. First, what are the parts of the gastrointestinal tract? They are six, and the accessory organs are also six. So the gastrointestinal tract starts by the oral cavity, then the pharynx, then the esophagus, then the stomach, then the small intestine, and the large intestine. So the six parts of the gastrointestinal tract are oral cavity, pharynx, esophagus, stomach, small intestine, and the large intestine. What are the accessory organs? They are six. Start by the teeth, the tongue, the salivary glands, and the salivary glands are three: parotid gland, submandibular gland, and the sublingual salivary gland. The liver, the gall bladder, and the pancreas. So the accessory organs are teeth, tongue, salivary glands, parotid, submandibular, and sublingual, the liver, the gallbladder, and the pancreas. So remember, the gastrointestinal tract is formed by six parts, and the accessory organs are also six. What is the name of this space? This space, what is the name of this space? It's called the vestibule. Which salivary duct, this duct, which salivary duct opens into the vestibule? It is the parotid duct. Okay. What is the largest salivary gland? The largest salivary gland is the parotid gland. This is the parotid gland. This is the submandibular salivary gland. This is the sublingual salivary gland. The largest one is the parotid gland. What are the salivary ducts which opens or which open into the mouth cavity proper? This is the mouth cavity proper. The submandibular duct and the sublingual ducts. So remember, the parotid duct opens into the vestibule, the submandibular and the sublingual ducts open into the mouth cavity proper. Regarding the teeth, okay, how many permanent teeth? The permanent teeth are 32, and they are present in the adult. 32, 16 in the upper jaw, and 16 in the lower jaw, and the 16, 8 on each side. How many deciduous teeth? Children, deciduous teeth, babies, are 20. 10 in the upper jaw, and 10 in the lower jaw, 5 on each side. So the permanent teeth are 32, and the deciduous teeth are 20. 32, 16 in the upper jaw, and 16 in the lower jaw. The deciduous teeth are 20. This is the total number. 10 in the upper jaw, and 10 in the lower jaw. Then the pharynx, this tube is called the pharynx. What are the three divisions of the pharynx? The three divisions of the pharynx are This is the first one, nasopharynx. And this nasopharynx is located behind the nasal cavity. The second one is the oropharynx, is present behind the oral cavity. And the third one is the laryngopharynx. And this laryngopharynx is located behind the larynx. And the laryngopharynx is continuous with the esophagus. This is the esophagus. So the pharynx is divided into three parts: nasopharynx, oropharynx, and laryngopharynx. This is the nasopharynx, this is the oropharynx. Name two structures in the nasopharynx. In this nasopharynx, this lymphoid tissue is called the adenoid or pharyngeal tonsil, and this opening is the opening of the eustachian tube or auditory tube. So two structures in the nasopharynx: pharyngeal tonsil or adenoid, and eustachian tube, opening of the eustachian tube. Name one structure in the oropharynx. This one, this is the palatine tonsil. Okay, so the palatine tonsil is located in the oropharynx. The pharyngeal tonsil is located in the nasopharynx. Which part of the pharynx is not part of the GIT? Of course, it is the laryngopharynx. It is the nasopharynx. So the nasopharynx is not part of the GIT. The oropharynx and the laryngopharynx are parts of the gastrointestinal tract. The laryngopharynx is continuous with the esophagus. Okay? So which part of the pharynx is not part of the GIT? It is the nasopharynx. Okay. What is the length of the esophagus? The length of the esophagus is 25 centimeters. Okay. About 10 inches. What is the length of the small intestine? The length of the small intestine is 6 meters. What is the length of the large intestine? 1.5 meters. What are the three parts of the small intestine? The three parts of the small intestine are: the first part is the jejunum, then jejunum, and ileum. So the three parts of the small intestine: duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. What is the length of each part? The duodenum is 25 centimeters long. It's about 10 inches. It is similar to the length of the esophagus. Regarding the jejunum is 40% the length of the small intestine, so it is about 2.5 meters. And the ileum is 60% the length of the small intestine, so it is about 3.5 meters. So the duodenum is 25 centimeters, the jejunum is 2.5 meters, the ileum is 3.5 meters. Which part of the GIT makes the intrinsic factor for vitamin B12 absorption? Okay, of course, it is the stomach. Okay. So the stomach secretes intrinsic factor, which is very important for vitamin B12 absorption. Where do you find Peyer's patches? Peyer's patches are present in the ileum. What are Peyer's patches? Peyer's patches are aggregations of lymphoid tissue. Where does the bile duct open? This is the bile duct. Where does the bile duct open? It opens into the duodenum. It opens into the second part of the duodenum. Where does the pancreatic duct open? This is the pancreatic duct. It also opens in the second part of the duodenum. So the intrinsic factor is secreted by the stomach. Pears patches are present in the ileum, and the pears patches are aggregations of lymphoid tissue, and the bile duct and the pancreatic duct open into the duodenum. This is the abdominal part of the esophagus, and this is the stomach. Okay, what are the parts of the stomach? The stomach is divided into two parts by a line from the angular notch to the greater curvature. This part is called the cardiac part, and this part is called the pyloric part. So the stomach is divided into cardiac part and the pyloric part. The cardiac part is divided into two parts. Fundus, above a line from the junction of the esophagus to the greater curvature, okay? And this part is the body. So the cardiac part of the stomach is divided into fundus, above a horizontal line from the esophagus to the greater curvature, and then the body. Regarding the pyloric part, it is divided into three parts. This dilated part is called the pyloric antrum, and this canal is called the pyloric canal, and this sphincter is called pyloric sphincter. So actually, the stomach is divided into five parts. Two belong to the cardiac part, and the three belong to the pyloric part. Fundus, body, pyloric antrum, pyloric canal, and the pyloric sphincter. List the four differences between the jejunum and the ileum. This is the jejunum, this is the ileum. The jejunum is the proximal 2/5. It is the proximal 40% of the small intestine. The ileum is the distal 60% of the small intestine. The ileum, the jejunum, has wider lumen. The ileum, narrower lumen. The characteristic feature of the jejunum, it has numerous mucus folds. That's why the wall is thicker than that of the ileum. So the jejunum has numerous mucus folds. The ileum has few mucus folds. That's why the wall of the ileum is thin. Regarding the pears patches, pears patches are present in the ileum, and the pears patches are not present in the jejunum. There are other differences. We'll discuss them when we study the abdomen. Okay, so the four differences between jejunum and the ileum. The jejunum is the proximal 2/5 of the small intestine. The ileum is the distal 3/5. The jejunum wider lumen. The ileum has narrower lumen. The jejunum has numerous mucus folds. The ileum has few mucus folds. The jejunum has no pears patches, and the ileum has pears patches, and the pears patches are collection aggregations of lymphoid tissue. This is the large intestine. Okay? What are the parts of the large intestine? The parts of the large intestine will start here. This one, the vermiform appendix. And then this one, the cecum. And then the ascending colon. The transverse colon. The descending colon. The sigmoid colon. The rectum. And the anal canal. So the large intestine is formed of vermiform appendix, cecum, ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum, and anal canal. There are two flexures here. This one is the right colic flexure, it's called the hepatic flexure, and this one is the left colic flexure, it's called the splenic flexure. List the five differences between the large intestine and the small intestine. This is the large intestine. Okay, it is 1.5 meters. Small intestine, 6 meters. The large intestine has 3 tinea coli. These bands, 3 bands of tinea coli. And the tinea coli are longitudinal muscle fibers, and they are present in all the large intestine except two parts, except the rectum and the vermiform appendix. So the rectum doesn't contain tinea coli, and the vermiform appendix also doesn't contain tinea coli. The small intestine, no tinea coli. The large intestine, the wall is sacculated. Okay, so there are sacculations in the large intestine, a smooth wall of the small intestine. Epiploic appendages. These are filled fat-filled pouches. No epiploic appendages in the small intestine. Large intestine has no villi in the mucosa. Small intestine contains villi in the mucosa. So, five differences between large intestine and the small intestine. Large intestine, 1.5 meters. Small intestine, 6 meters. Large intestine has 3 tinea coli. Small intestine has no tinea coli. Tinea coli are longitudinal bands of muscle fibers. They are present in all parts of the large intestine except the rectum and vermiform appendix. The wall of the large intestine is sacculated. The wall of the small intestine is smooth. The large intestine has epiploic appendages. The small intestine has no epiploic appendages. Epiploic appendages are fat-filled pouches. And the large intestine, the mucosa of the large intestine, doesn't contain villi. The mucosa of the small intestine contains many villi. What is the main function of the small intestine? The main function of the small intestine is absorption. What are the structural modifications to increase absorption? Structural modifications in the small intestine to increase absorption. Number one, the mucosa of the small intestine is folded to increase the surface area by 3 folds. So the first structural modification is the folded mucosa. The second one, the mucosa has villi, and these villi increase the surface area 10 folds. And the villi contains microvilli. The villi has microvilli, okay? And these microvilli increase the surface area 20 folds. So the structural modifications to increase absorption are: the mucosa is folded, the mucosa has villi, and the villi have microvilli. Okay, so these are the structural modifications in the small intestine to increase absorption. Folded mucosa, presence of villi, and the presence of microvilli. Now, what are the functions of the liver? What are the functions of the gallbladder? And what are the functions of the pancreas? Regarding the liver, what are the functions of the liver? Of course, the first function is production of bile. So the bile is produced by the liver. Second function is production of blood proteins, albumin. Storage of glucose as glycogen. Stores fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K. And metabolizes lipids and amino acids. And detoxification of drugs, alcohol, and poisons. So again, what are the functions of the liver? Two production, two storage, and then metabolism and detoxification. Production of bile, production of blood proteins, albumin. Storage, glucose as glycogen, and fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, K. So vitamins, vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E, and vitamin K are stored in the liver. Metabolizes lipids and amino acids, and detoxifies drugs, alcohol, and poisons. What is the function of the gallbladder? The function of the gallbladder is storage and concentration of bile. So regarding bile, bile is secreted by the liver and is stored in the gallbladder. So bile, secreted by the liver, stored in the gallbladder. What are the functions of the pancreas? The pancreas is a combined gland. It is endocrine and exocrine gland. So it has two parts. The exocrine part secretes pancreatic juice, digestive enzymes, and the endocrine part produces insulin and glucagon. So again, functions of the pancreas. Pancreas is formed of two parts, exocrine part and endocrine part. The exocrine part is responsible for secretion of pancreatic juice for digestion, and the endocrine part is responsible for production of insulin and glucagon. And thank you very much. Best wishes and good luck.